treated this weekend were the result of police brutality. Shame! Such injuries that we saw included head injuries, fractures, soft tissue injuries, broken bones. I myself was bruised and cut by a police person who hit me with a bicycle as I was providing first aid to somebody who had been pepper sprayed. Were not incurred during the 90 minutes of corporate property discretion that took place on Saturday. Those 90 minutes which the media has chosen to sensationalize. In fact, the majority of the most devastating injuries that we saw occurred during peaceful protests. Horses, pepper spray, violent undercover snatch and grabs occurred on Saturday evening during a peaceful demonstration. The use of rubber bullets and extreme physical force was employed during a peaceful demonstration on Eastern Ave.
Criminal!
Shame!
We saw our tax dollars being spent to harass medics as we were stopped multiple times. We had our packs dismantled, our gear confiscated. We identified as medics and we had all of our gauze, our water, our liquid antacid confiscated.
Criminal!
So a lot of what we all saw on Saturday, Sunday, that was really bad. And we are still dealing with the after effects. And I have to say that although we underestimated as medics the kinds of injuries and the number of injuries that we saw, we were prepared. And I'm proud to say that many of the people amongst you right now provided excellent first aid services. What we have not been prepared for has been the fallout post G20. We thought our jobs as medics would end with the last demonstration on Sunday, but in fact it had just begun. The dismal conditions in which people were kept during their respective detentions have very serious impacts on people's health. Over the past few days, we have been scrambling, trying to locate medications. We have been seeing people who have been kept without insulin for days. No thyroid medication, people without food and water in extremely, extremely stressful conditions. We have been treating wounds that were inflicted during the protest by police, and then they were infected during the incarceration of our fellow activists. Many people were released from out of province or out of country and have no insurance, and they were released without identification, released without their health cards. Their psychological and emotional trauma due to the conditions they were incarcerated in will have lasting impacts that cannot be predicted. There's so much to talk about. I wish I could just share the stories of everybody that's been coming forward. I know this is a bit long, but what we are questioning as medics is how could this happen?
How
could this happen in a state that chose to spend $1.5 billion on what it defines as security? What is security for a state if medics were what we're asking is that what is security for the state if as medics we treated hundreds of injuries that incurred during this weekend, the majority of which were perpetrated by police who had been hired to protect and to secure the people of Toronto. Who was protected? What was protected? Not us, not our rights.
Criminals!
While I was doing my job working for Our Times magazine, I stopped to shoot footage of reporters who themselves had been arrested while reporting the news. I presented my media credentials. I was told they were fake. I was arrested brutally along with colleagues who were other journalists. We were knocked to the ground. We were belittled. We were humiliated.
Criminal!
Shame!
Shame!
out now about what the conditions in the jail and detention centers were like. People are beginning to hear about the conditions under which people were repressed, detained, and arrested in the streets. And a lot of questions from those of us who are not here are things like, that couldn't possibly happen here. This is Canada. That couldn't happen in this city. How would it happen? Why would a police officer say to a female journalist, you're not going to want to be a journalist anymore after we finished raping you?
Yeah!
To a journalist with video cameras rolling, and I'll tell you why. One, because they think they're above the law.
Yeah. The law!
Two, because they arrested and repressed people who were witnessing and standing by to bear witness.
Criminal!
Three, because they smashed the equipment, the memory cards, the flash drives, the cameras, the sound recorders of the journalists who were there to take the news to the people, which is you! This is very important. It's not just women who were threatened with rape. I mean, not that that's not bad enough. Well, I want you to know that I have talked to people. I've had young men crying in my arms as they've told me about the kinds of violent rape threats that police uttered to them as they were being arrested. This is not isolated to one woman or to any particular group. We're talking about mass threats of sexual violence because the police think that they can discredit us and make us disbelieved.
Shame.
And I'm sorry, Chrissy Blatchard. I'm sorry, Chrissy Blatchard of the Globe and Mail, if you don't believe it, but quite frankly, you weren't there beside me. Were women violently strip searched? Yes, they were, because I was there and I saw them.
Shame.
To the moment I was released, I was targeted as a journalist, someone bringing the news to the people. I was targeted as part of a sexual minority. I was targeted as a woman.
Shame!
People have begun to ask me, people who care about me have begun to ask me, Lisa, how are you doing? I hope the dust is beginning to settle. I hope the healing has just started. And I'm going to tell you, candidly, I'm only just now starting to feel the shame, the fear, the humiliation.
Don't let them break your spirit.
It's not. It's just starting now. It's just starting to flood. And that's going to be the same for many others who are here, who are not here, those who were arrested and detained, even those who simply witnessed that kind of brutal violence. We're all going to be affected. But it's not going to break us. This is just the beginning.